This is Ed Cicale with Athletic Strength and Power Podcasts. I'm with Rocky Boiman at the 700 WLW radio studio, where we'll be talking about all things NFL football with him. First, I'll tell you about the Bill Jacobs Power Company. I've known Bill Jacobs for a very long time, Coach Jake, and what he's involved with in his business, which is the Bill Jacobs Power Company, is building your athletic facility from the bottom up. In fact, that's his main slogan. And from the ground up, they'll help you create the athletic facility that best fits your needs and budget. He's got everything from flooring to racks, bands. He can work your locker room and get you plates, bumper plates, iron plates, rubberized plates, every kind of bar that you need, machines. That's his area. This is his business. This is his job. This is his life. Anything dealing with athletic equipment, cardio. His goal is to help you provide the best environment possible for your athlete's success. And at the WLW studios right here in Cincinnati, Ohio, it's a huge radio operation. They're also on iHeartRadio, and it used to be called the Big One. I don't know if you still call
it. Still the Big One. That's right.
It's pretty big. And I'm speaking of the Big One, I am with the Big One. That's Rocky Boiman, a former Notre Dame Fighting Irish captain. He also played locally here in Cincinnati, and he played for St. X High School. It's a huge high school football power in Ohio. If you don't, Rocky, I will let you know that we have thousands of listeners to our podcast.
That's
not
right.
Quite as many as the Big One here,
it's
getting
okay.
Millions of voters.
I am one of your listeners, so that's good.
Well, thank you. Once again, I'm with Rocky Boiman. He starred at Notre Dame as a captain, and then he was drafted by the Tennessee Titans down in Nashville. I'm in the studio with him. It's his studio, really, but welcome back.
Ed, happy to be with you, buddy. You and I have known each other a good 15 years, and going back with our mutual friend, Ted Lambourdinas, the great Ted Lambourdinas, and, training together. Remember running some of those deathly Saturday morning workout, whatever, the 20 half-gassers and all that sort of stuff we used to do. I used to see you out there getting after it. And, again,
yes,
it's been fun to know you these last couple years.
Yeah, an inspiration to us all the guys that were training with Dr. Ted at the time, Troy Evans.
Yeah.
I mean, you guys were flying up and down the field. I don't know how you guys flew up and down the field like that. You guys have a natural genetic thing going.
Well, my days of flying up and down the field are over. People always ask me that. They're like, could you play if the Bengals wanted to sign you? I'm like, no. Like, I've been out 10 years. Jeez. And I can honestly say, so I had an 8-year NFL career, and it was great. It was wonderful. And I felt like after, 2-3 years being out of the league, I could – give me 2-3 months. I could get back into shape and give you something. I could give you nothing right now. Nothing. I mean, it just shows you the elite level of shape that those guys are in, and just the youth and everything. Because, I mean, I'd get hurt in the first 15 minutes of practice. So.
Yeah, I hear you. Well, you would know. If you could tell us a little bit about the draft day experience that you had.
Yeah, so I was drafted in 2002, as you said, after a 4-year career at Notre Dame. Where I was a captain, and came out in the draft that year in 2002. And I went to the NFL Combine and did really, really well at the NFL Combine, which really helped me because I had had a great junior year. And my senior year, we wound up going to a kind of a different defensive scheme. It didn't really highlight what I could do. So anyway, the Combine kind of helped me, show teams, at least athletically where I was at. So that happened, and I talked to a bunch of teams there, and I kind of, through my agent, we gauged I'd go in about the fourth round, and that's exactly where I went. I was like the third to last pick in the fourth round. It was the Tennessee Titans. Up to that point, it was the greatest day in my athletic life, sitting there in this little house in Ross, Ohio, with my mom and my dad. And my sister, who had been with me for my whole entire athletic career, and right there, my dad working with me all the time, constantly. And then to get the phone call, and he's like, hey, hello, is Rocky there? Yeah, this is Rocky. This is so-and-so from the Tennessee Titans. It's funny, I think it was Jeff Fisher, the head coach, but I was so, just shocked and nervous. Hello, He's like, yeah, this is so-and-so of the Tennessee Titans. So we're going to go ahead and draft you right now. I was like, okay, and I'm pointing the TV because I can't talk. I'm listening to what he's saying. I'm pointing the TV like, they're going to draft me. They're going to draft me. And then my name goes across the screen, and my dad, Ed, I've seen my dad. My dad's a man's man, right?
Yes, sir.
I've seen my dad cry like probably five times in my entire life, and he broke down right there on and just fell to the floor. You know, seeing his son get drafted and make a dream a reality was something else. And, you know, went down to Tennessee with the Titans and, you know, had four great years there and then on after that. But it was wonderful. Draft day is nothing like it. And I always just feel so happy for those kids because everybody going in the draft has a unique experience in their life and things they've had to overcome. And to see that dream become a reality is something else. I love it.
That's crazy. I mean, the draft, and then what do you do? Like, I wouldn't be able to sleep, first of all, but, you know, you get that call, and then do they say, hey, come on down to Nashville in a week or two, or what are they?
Yeah, so a lot of teams will have, so the draft that weekend, they'll have their first rookie minicamp the following weekend. Now, for whatever reason, the Titans, there was a week in between, so it was like, okay, in 2 weeks it'll be your first minicamp. So I went back to Notre Dame where I was, you know, I was still hadn't graduated yet.
Oh,
so I went back and, you know, took my classes and was a regular college student again for about a week, and then went down there. And then I had actually kind of worked ahead, like knowing that, you know, or at least hoping that I was going to be playing in the NFL. So I got a lot of my classes done. So by the time I went down there, I wound up staying down there for good and never went back to Notre Dame. Obviously, I graduated and everything, but that was that.
Yeah, life-changing event and Cincinnati kid. Then you go down to camp when the big guys, the veterans are there. Then what happens? I mean, what do you – there's stars everywhere.
Right. Two things popped out to me in my first mini camp experience. Number one was – the speed. I mean, the speed, as everyone says, that is the distinct difference. You know, the linemen are fast. You know, the defensive linemen are quick. You know, these are 330-pound guys. So that was number one. Number two, I also distinctly recall just seeing the precision up close for the first time between the quarterback and the wide receivers in particular. A pass that was – in college, you know, a wide receiver makes a catch in practice that everyone would have been jumping up and down. Oh, my God, that's just the best play ever. That was a routine play where a quarterback would – I remember, you know, Steve McNair would be fitting balls in these windows that were, you know, literally the size of a football. And, you know, and I'd be like, oh, my God, that's an amazing throw and catch. And no one was jumping up and down. I was like, that's how it is, like every play here.
Wow.
And so that I remember that distinctly thinking that. And then also I also remember after my last minicamp being – and that was a three-day minicamp. And I remember after that thinking to myself, if I could go back to college right now, just after 3 days of competing at this level, I would dominate college football, right? Like you just kind of got that, just the speed and the precision and the coaching was incredible. I remember thinking that too. So that was kind of my reactions of my first mini camp.
Yeah, and then you get ready for the season, and there's a few preseason games and things like that. But when was it? Did you play right away, or was it a game or two you had to settle in, or how'd that happen? And then and did you know you were going to play that day?
Yeah, so I knew pretty early on that I was at least going to be on special teams because, I mean, right from day one with the full, you know, in mini camps and then in the fall camp, from day one, I was on the punt team, the kickoff team, kickoff return, punt return. And obviously I had to earn my spot, but they had the idea, look, we think after watching this guy, he can be an advantage for us here. And so I took that and ran with it, and that was great. And I'll tell you about my first NFL game. So my first NFL game, we played the Eagles, which – in Nashville, and our day, it was hot. I mean, it was 90-something degrees, super hot, to the point where we wore our all-white uniforms at home because it was that where we were trying to stay cool. And we beat the Eagles that day, and I had four tackles on special teams in my first NFL game, and I was like – and after the game, we go out and have fun. And I was like, this NFL thing is great. I highly recommend it to everybody. So then, you know, did all special teams that year. Played situationally. I was on, you know, goal line and short yardage. We had a package called the extra linebacker package where we bring a fourth linebacker in. I was in on that. So I was playing situationally in special teams. And then that year, I actually set the franchise record for special teams tackles in a season. with 26, and I believe that record still stands. That's the Titans Oilers franchise record for special teams tackles in a season.
That's pretty cool.
And I narrowly missed making a Pro Bowl. I was on a ballot, and I Larry Izzo, who went to a ton of Pro Bowls with the Patriots, I wound up getting it. But yeah, it's close.
Wow. And so when you finally go through all the pregame warm-ups and everything, and then you go back in the locker room, and then you come out for real, and you come through the tunnel there, and there you are, a rookie, and you look out and see like 70,000 people out there on a hot day in Nashville.
Yeah, no, it was great. And playing at Notre Dame, I'd obviously played in a ton of big environments. So the environment wasn't that overwhelming. But and I also, by the time you go through camp, I remember getting to a point in camp also where I felt like I belonged. I'm like, this is real. Like I can play at this level. And it was a really great feeling that overcame me. And after competing and winning some battles and doing well and stuff, I remember, so it wasn't like I went into that game thinking this game is bigger than me. I was like, I belong out here. I can play at this level, and went in there with some confidence. And we had a great season, too. We went to the AFC Championship game. We lost to the Raiders out there in Oakland. We were one game away from the Super Bowl. So it was a pretty fantastic year.
And before we continue with Rocky, here's a quick word about Black Iron Strength. Black Iron Strength manufactures the only commercial-grade adjustable dumbbells and has the patent on antimicrobial copper handles, which protects the user 24/7 from germs. BlackIronStrength.com.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then there you are, a rookie linebacker getting in some real regular defensive action. Mm-hmm. And then, I imagine big guards and a tackle now and then are scraping around and coming through. And and there you are.
I remember seeing
– much lighter.
I remember seeing Larry Allen, who's a great Larry. Well, Larry Allen, too. He was a guard for the Cowboys for forever.
Yeah.
And then also Lincoln Kennedy. He was a guard for the Raiders. And I remember, like, after a play, you know, just kind of, you know, you're getting up from the pile and stuff and standing next to him and thinking – that isn't any. That's a bigger version of a human being. Like that. Like that guy is so enormous. Him, Jonathan Ogden, had arms that were. I mean, a huge guy, but also had arms that could reach out and, you know, 6 feet social distancing. He would have been able to make that up with his reach. Just some of these guys were, especially Lincoln Kennedy. God, he was so, is so big. But yeah, it's a different deal seeing how the size of some of those guys out there.
And of course, sometimes those guys come out of nowhere. You think you're in the clear, you're going to make a tackle, right. And then what?
Yeah.
Bam.
Because they can move. That's the thing. And in college, you know, some of the bigger, there's bigger guys out there too. There's guys that are over 300 and something pounds. For the most part, they don't move like they do in the NFL.
And then I'm sure, you know, in your first few years in the National Football League, you know, you experienced a dude running into him or tackling him or whatever, and you just went, wow.
Here's a funny story. So I think I've only had two concussions in my life playing football. Both happened in the NFL, and one of them was on Monday night against the Patriots. And this was my rookie year or second year. I think it was my rookie year. Ran down kickoff, and Mike Vrabel was in the wedge. And I'm thinking running down like I'm gonna put Mike Vrabel on his ass right now. I'm going over top of him. And I went down, Ed, and I hit him with everything I had, and he hit me right back. Boom! Just it was like two rams you see on those nature shows where they just hit and they kind of, and I was I came out of that with a concussion though. So Coach Vrabel got the better of me right there. I remember thinking I'm gonna take him out, man. This is gonna be great. And he said, Nah, Bubba, nah.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Of course, coming out of Notre Dame, and then tell us a little bit about the strength training that went on up there, and then all of a sudden you get to the National Football League, and now it's, you know.
It's your job.
It's your job.
Right.
It's got to be fun, just the training and everything.
Yeah, it was. And I've always enjoyed training. I've been just a total nut about it, and just love that whole environment. Love being in the gym, love learning. You know, and learning about Dr. Ken Leisner and, you know, all these guys and Boyd Epley and all these famous names and strength. I grew up idolizing these guys, you know. So then my trainer and obviously working out with Ted, worked out with him when I was younger, and then he obviously trained me a lot in the NFL as well. But in college, my strength coach was Mickey Marotti, very, very famous. Now with the Iowa State Buckeyes. And Yeah, so learned a ton from him. Just he was a, you know, one of the patriarchs of the high intensity training, the HIIT stuff, and where you go in the gym and you just throw maximum effort out there. We're not going to be there long, but we're going to get after it, and we're going to, you know, just beat you up and send you on your way. So really enjoyed Mick. Mick and I, you know, still, you know, have a good relationship. You know, obviously, he's had tremendous success. Learned a lot from him. Learned a lot about strength training, and became in one. I remember I came in at I was 215 my senior year of high school, and by the start of my sophomore year, I was 245. So I put on about 30. Now to be fair, I probably put on a little too much, and I wound up coming back and down a little bit and playing to my normal playing weight about 238. But just shows you when those kids get in the training room and get in that weight room. And
what was it, Watterson?
Yeah, Steve Watterson was was a head coach, strength coach, down with the Tennessee Titans, and loved Watterson. He was just a crazy, high intensity, high energy guy as well, and he made things a lot of fun. It's a little different, college strength coaches versus pro, because you know, in college, first of all, you're a college athlete, you're just a kid, you know, so they can just pound you and, you know, whatever, just get after it. And in the NFL, it's a little different because, you know, these are multi-million dollar commodities that you're now training. So you can't, you know, it's hard to tell a guy making, you know, $10 million a year, hey, go do these board pushes and then do a 2-minute wall sit, and then now we're going to flip tires. He's going to say, you go to hell. Right. That's not what I do. So so there's a little bit more, you know, so but I look, we still got after down there and had a lot of great training, and I really like the program he led.
And before we continue with Rocky, this ASAP podcast is brought to you by Team Builder, the online strength and conditioning platform for coaches and their athletes. Team Builder. A little bit about the playoffs. When you make the playoffs, that's kind of a whole new deal.
Oh, it's a whole new deal because and it is true. It just the pace of the game picks up. It's everyone's playing a little bit harder, a little bit faster, a little bit of everything. And yeah, it's just, you know, you read about all these great players that never won a playoff game and never even played. Like, I think Dick Butkus never won a playoff game. I don't think he even played in one either.
Yeah, right.
So especially in my rookie year, to go to the playoffs and then make it all the way to the AFC Championship game was pretty cool. So yeah, that's what you play for. There's nothing like being on a team that's winning and going to the playoffs. And you know, the free agency is going on right now, and I know guys are chasing the money, and I get it. Rarely do you ever get an opportunity to capitalize and make generational wealth. I get it, but man, there's something to be said about going to a team that's good and that's winning and that you like and likes you. That's sometimes, so there's things money can't buy. There's a lot of things money can't buy, but being on a great team that's winning and doing big things and being talked about is truly wonderful.
You know, the other thing that you got to do was not only make it to the Super Bowl, you guys won the Super Bowl. That's a rare thing in life for somebody to get to play in the Super Bowl as a football player.
It's every kid's dream. I always say this to folks, if you're a little kid and you've played football for 5 minutes or 5 years or anything in between, you've dreamt about playing the Super Bowl, right? And any kid who's ever played backyard football, what do you do? Hey, all right, so we're in the Super Bowl. This is for the Super Bowl, or we're this team or we're that team. You dream about it. And I started playing football when I was 7 years old. And in my first year as a 7-year-old, won our Super Bowl, right? With the Bridgetown Little Highlanders, won a couple of them actually. And
the Little Highlanders,
and so we, so that was cool. But then, yeah, so that's the thing every kid dreams about, and then to go and to actually win it is great. I remember after the game, and I can say this was consistent with every player on the team. We were excited, we were elated, and all that. But there's a lot of relief that goes on too, because you can't think, I mean, a Super Bowl run takes 23-24 games. You got 4 games in the preseason plus 16, that's 20, and then 3 playoff games and then the Super Bowl. To go 24 games and not get the ultimate prize would just be devastating.
Yes,
and I've talked to guys that have been on teams that have lost Super Bowls, and they're like, God, after the game you're like, well, I don't even want to think about playing again, because like, we got to do all that, try to do all that again. So I feel definitely blessed that we were able to not just get there, but win it when we were there.
I guess you guys, what, go down to the Super Bowl site about a week before?
Yeah, so we get all the heavy lifting done and practicing done in Indianapolis, in this case, when I was with the Colts, that week that next week after the AFC Championship game, and then we go down to ours was in Miami. And down there, once you're down there, you're not doing super hard practices. You're just kind of just making sure you're, you know, staying fit and staying sharp on everything, knowing the game plan and executing, and then staying fresh and going out for the game.
Did you ever get your hands on Tom Brady or one of those star quarterbacks?
Hey, so this is funny. So this is my second year. We went up to New England. I was with the Titans. Started that game, and we went up losing. But anyway, on a blitz, I came through, and I sacked Tom Brady. But our defensive lineman had illegal hands to the face. So it negated the sack. So, like, I have this great picture of me sacking Tom Brady, but
nullified.
According to the rule book, it didn't count. If you look at my stats, it didn't count. It was like, Yeah.
Right
yeah.
There,
there you go.
How about linebacker play? Let's shift to a little bit about linebacker. And what are the characteristics that you have to have? Say you're a high school kid out there listening to our podcast or a high school coach. How do you select a linebacker? What do you look for?
I think the first thing you got to have is you got to love physicality. You got to love it. And I know the game today is more in space and it's spread out and all that. And there's not the powers and the ISO blocks and fullbacks and all that stuff like there was even when I played. But you still got to love contact. You can't just be okay with it. You got to love it. You got to relish it. And you just got to excite you the feeling of imposing your will upon another human being. You got to like that, and you got to be tough. I think that's number one. You can be as athletic as you want. There's a lot of kids running around in shorts that look good at linebacker position, and I've seen them. You come out. I've seen guys, you know, free agents come in the NFL out of college, and it's during training camp and the first mini camp. That's, you know, not in pads, and they're running around. Boy, they look real good in shorts. And then the pads come on. It's a completely different story. So you got to love that. And you also got to be a student of the game. I think, you know, just from a mindset and just all that goes into the position, you have to like studying the game, and you have to want to know and desire to know all the ins and outs and all the different intricacies of the position, and that's what I learned as every year it went by, is just learning the little tells and the things formationally and the things to look out for to set yourself up. Because the more you can do pre-snap to give yourself a better chance to make a play, the better you're going to be. So, yeah, it's a game that it's a position that, yeah, I love playing. You know, ever since I was a safety in high school, but really I was a deep linebacker. You know, so I played the position in one way or another for a while and loved it.
The other guy I think about that came out of your high school was a superstar NFL is Luke Kuechly.
Yeah.
I know you got to work with him and hang with him and stuff like that.
Yeah, he's obviously one of the best to ever play the game in that position in the modern era for sure, certainly within the last, you know, quarter century. And for him, it was just a lot of the instincts and just the knowledge of, okay, what are they trying to do to me? That's what when I talk to young linebackers, I was like, every time you go to the line, you should try to think, what are they trying to do to me? What is the offense trying to do? They're not getting in this formation for the fun of it. They're doing it for some sort of advantage they think they can get over you. So you got to figure out what that is and make sure they don't get that advantage, whether it's, you know, putting the formation into the boundary and getting you to, you know, to scoot over so they can get a better angle on you for their lineman to come out, whatever it is. So you got to be one step ahead of that. And I just think Luke was one of the best at it. And a lot of what he had is, yes, he studied and all that, but I mean, he just had the God-given instincts to play the position that few had. And then he just relish playing the position as well.
Your coach at Tennessee Titans, Jeff Fisher, he was a defensive type of coach, wasn't he?
He was, yeah. He was with the you know, the 85 Bears.
Okay, yeah.
So he's definitely a defensive guy. We still had in our game plan some of that old 46 Bears defense, and we would run it every once in a while. I think it was just to pleasure him. He's like the fact that we were still doing it sometimes, whether it was what we needed to do or not, but. Yeah, he's a defensive guy.
Rocky, how about these, Ted Lamonitis and I, we've traveled all over the country, been to your school, Notre Dame, and, of course, Ohio State, Clemson, Alabama. These guys, and which I think is awesome, are really dining in some dining centers now designed for the finest, and they deserve it. And I just think it's so cool that, the food is unbelievable.
And the facilities, the food, everything, and not to get on this tangent, but this is always my argument for I'm against the college athletes being paid for a lot of reasons. I don't want to get into it, but for one of them is, I mean, my God, like you just alluded to, the facilities, the training tables, the doctors, the massage therapists. I mean, go down to Clemson. They have a barbecue pit. They have an outdoor wiffle ball field. They have outdoor basketball courts. They got a weight room that they is multi-millions of dollars that they renovate like every 2 years. And you're around the best coaches, the best training staff, the best of everything. And it's like, man, that's a pretty good deal. I mean, there's a lot of – somebody find me – an extra year of college eligibility. Let me go back to college and live that life. I mean, it's one of those things. It's, I know everyone wants to put a dollar value on everything today and okay, well, this kid deserves this because of that. I understand that, but I bet you there's people out there, Ed, that would pay $1 million to run out of the tunnel and hit play like a champion today sign at Notre Dame. People would pay $10 million to do that. We get to do that for free. I got to, you know, train at the University of Notre Dame and run out of the tunnel and put on that gold helmet every day for free. So, again, I know folks feel one way or another on that issue, but I'm for many, many reasons, I think it's such a blessing and such a tremendous opportunity these kids get to have. They get to do that, and these facilities these days are absolutely unbelievable.
Oh, they are. You know, and I think, like you say, you know, it's evolved, and it started out as it's amateur, but, you know, and they try to maintain that amateur status,
right?
And some things slip through, but still, it's you're getting a heck of a deal no matter where you go.
And you're 22 years old, and you're starting your adult life with zero college debt. I mean, college debt is one of the things that's absolutely crippling young people. They're trying to start their life and start a family and start their career with $250,000 in college loan debt. That's a tremendous burden that they're not paying off for 10 years or more. I know, I understand, I get the argument of because trust me, athletes go above and they earn every penny of their scholarship. They really do, because the hours you put in and, you know, the times you're working out at 5 a.m. and, you know, then you go the whole day, you're taking class and you go to practice and you go eat and you go to training table or you go to study hall and it's 10 o'clock before you're getting to bed and then you get up and do that same thing again. That's a hell of a schedule. So I'm not disparaging that. But, again, I think, you know, the athletes, they earn that scholarship, but what an advantage to start life with.
Yeah. Well, Rocky, I know you got to go pretty soon here, but if you could tell us a little bit about this radio gig you got going here in Cincinnati. It's really cool. I mean, everybody's listening to it all the time. Hey, did you hear Rocky today or Eddie? Or, you know, the Rocky and Eddie show, I guess.
Yeah, that's right. So, so this is my – I guess I've worked for 700 WLW for, I don't know, let's say 7 years. But since 2017, it's been the Eddie and Rocky show. So this is God, I guess our fourth year of me and Eddie Fingers doing it. And Eddie Fingers is a legend. I grew up listening to him on my way to high school every morning when he was on the Dawn Patrol with WEBN.
Right. And rocking
EBN. And just absolutely loved it, loved him. And for me to now be able to say I work with him every day, it's like pinch me. You know what I mean? It's incredible. It really is. And he and I have a really great dynamic. And we, you know, just how our back and forth and our chemistry, I think, is real good. It's good because we genuinely like each other. And we don't agree on everything, but deep down we generally like and care and love one another, which is important. So we have a great show and we cover just about everything. We do serious, we do light, we do, you know, funny, we do local, we do national, we do sports, we do politics, we do human interest, you know, everything. And so I think it's an interesting listen because even if you don't like the topic we're doing, just wait about 8 minutes and we'll probably be on something else. Yeah. You know what I mean? So it's not like if you're doing a all day Clemson football radio show, well, that's a long time to be talking about the same thing all the time. We get the freedom to be able to talk about a lot of things, especially things outside of sports is really cool and blessed to work here. And, just a lot of great people. And Willie Cunningham obviously is a legend and getting to learn under him. And it's been I never said, hey, I want to grow up and be a radio host. It's one of those things that kind of happened. I was getting involved, and, you know, I still call college football games for ESPN, and that was kind of the route when I got out of the NFL. I looked mostly at going, but through certain circumstances, kind of wound up getting pulled in the direction of doing, you know, talk radio, which, is again, came out of completely nowhere, but it's, I mean, wow, what a blessing, because it's such a fun job to do.
Yeah, that's really cool. I mean, and then when you listen to you guys, when I'm listening to you guys driving down I-75 or wherever I am, I've tuned you in on iHeartRadio when I'm out in the middle of California desert.
There you go. That's right.
But it's cool. It's like you're almost sitting with you guys and, you know, having lunch or breakfast and talking about all kinds of stuff that's relevant, you know?
Yeah, that's right. That's what we try to do. And our news department does a great job of just, okay, here's what's going on just from a news standpoint. And
before we continue with Rocky, this ASAP video is brought to you by Pit Shark Strength Training Equipment. We've visited all of the top strength complexes in the U.S., Pit Shark is everywhere. Check them out at loadthebar.com.
Again, radio is, and I learned this. I had to learn this early on, and I think everybody does that gets into it. It's still about entertainment, you know. And you got to be enlightenment and entertainment. You got to have knowledge. You got to know your stuff, but you can't go on there and try to give a school lesson every day and prove how smart you are. You got to be entertaining. You got to be funny, or because there's so many things out there people can listen to. And I think most people, yes, they want information, but they also, you want to be entertained. You want to laugh a little bit. You want to, just kind of chuckle to yourself about something. And I think that's what we strive to do.
And then if we wrap up here, Rocky, just a little bit more on your ESPN gig. I know that's... It gets you right back to football, and that's really deep down in your roots. You love talking about football, watching football, and analyzing the game. And then, when the guys upstairs, I guess somehow they, you're hearing what they're talking through the engineers or whatever, and they tell you, let's go, Rocky, you're on.
Yeah.
Tell us what's going on down on the field.
Yeah, that's it, man. Well, and this year was great because, I was back in the booth full time. I was doing sideline analyst stuff for about 4 years. And then doing a little bit of, in the booth. And this last year I was fully back up in the booth, which was great. Mm-hmm. And you're right. But that's what I like about it is you get to be around the game and around the kids and learn scheme. And I was a student of the game, and I take that, my experience there with me. And then from there, I just try to talk about the kids, try to tell the viewer the why. Why did that happen? Here's from my perspective and my experience. This is why that play worked, or why that play didn't work, or why the running back made the touchdown, or why the linebacker did this. That's what I try to constantly in my head think, okay, this is what the listener wants. And then, again, do it in an entertaining, fun way. If I'm calling a game and I'm having fun, I think the listeners are having fun.
Folks, Rocky Boiman, he might tell me that he's not quite ready for NFL games again, but I think if he started working out with Ted again for a couple more weeks and got the call, he could surely at least look the part out there.
I would say I would look the part until you asked me to actually do anything, and then it'd fall apart.
I mean, we're talking 6'4". You got to be 225 or something here, Rocky.
Yeah. Hanging in there. Doing okay.
But once again, Rocky Boiman, thanks for joining us with this ASAP Athletic Strength and Power podcast. I'm going to head back and grab some bands on my way home and try to, work the muscles a little bit better.
There you go.
Bill Jacobs Power Company.
Jacobs is a great man. I know Bill. I've known Bill a long time. He does a great job. He helped me get some equipment for back when I had my training facility. So he's a great man. But again, thanks to you, Ed. Again, always enjoyed our friendship over the past decade or more, and it's great to see you, and great to see you still doing great things. I check out the podcast whenever I can, whenever I'm, driving some college town or something,
Yeah.
get to turn it on, and you always do a great job, so thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Rocky, and thanks for joining us with this ASAP Athletic Strength and Power podcast from Cincinnati, Ohio, at the WLW Recording Studios today.
Thank you.